So welcome to the third day of the Aesthetic Activism Symposium. Today's a little bit different. Today we're starting out with a symposium, or with a panel more filled with people more actually engaged in the acts of activism. And the question is how aesthetics fits into their discourse. I just wanted to remind everyone that there's no single reading for aesthetics that we're trying to get at. There's no claim that we're trying to have verified. There's no terminology that needs to be debunked or dismissed. This is, again, as I said before, an invitation to curiosity. So today's sessions are the kind of take on activism through different perspectives. There are, of course, many, 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 many more out there, but these are ones I thought might be fruitful to the discussion. Some don't really mention aesthetics at all, but I think it might be embedded in their discourse. Some are more explicit about it. And then we'll have a panel with most architects to talk about the implications for any or all of this or none of this to architecture in terms of a contemporary idea about how we might continue to practice. And part of that is also asking if aesthetics, which I believe has been largely what identifies a progressive or a new movement within architecture, regardless of what's under the ambitions of a movement, like, say, deconstruction, it's the aesthetic of the movement that identifies it as progressive to the public. Now, that's something I'm sure the architects on this panel will, by virtue of anything I say, will naturally fight against it, just to have something to talk about, if for no other reason. But that panel will just also ask if that's true. Is that true today? Is that something which is still fruitful to think of? Is it not fruitful to think of? Can aesthetics be considered with a different relationship to architecture now that's maybe not so superficial, not just so associated with the look of things, which is easily dismissed? So we're going to have all these questions on the table, and then we're going to end the final session with a look of estrangement and the aesthetics of otherness, the aesthetics of unfamiliarity. And we have a mix of artists and curators and architects on that panel. And that should end us in a very weird and interesting place. And then we'll have the final concluding remarks by David Rue, whose work has been kind of instrumental in bringing a lot of these topics to the table of architecture in general. So I think he'll have some interesting concluding remarks. So now I'd like to turn the panel over to Peggy Deamer, who will be moderating it. She was introduced last night, and thank you very much for doing this, especially so early in the morning. But I saw that she had had some dialogue with the participants last night at dinner. So I hope we will tease out some interesting embers and directions towards activism. Thank you.
Thank you all for being here. It is early, and it's a weekend, and it's a pretty day. But I think we're going to have a fabulous morning. So I do want to welcome you to this morning's session, which is the Aesthetics of Activism, Afro-Futurism, Xenofeminism, and Disobedient Objects. The fact that this category is identified not by a common theme, but by the three individual subjects offered by our three speakers is indication not just of its diversity, but we might call its incommensurability. I fear that giving a unified character to these three activisms would mischaracterize the very, very thoughtful, unique, and carefully formulated approaches that they all have to activism and aestheticism, their relationship. Nevertheless, I will try to say some binding things about what we will hear this morning about their themes and about the speakers. One, all three are kick-ass women who I've had the pleasure to get to know over these last 2 days. Our conversations that we've had in private have been almost as meaningful to me as what we're hearing in really fabulous sessions yesterday and the night before. Two, each of them do indeed believe in activism, a subject that has been a bit elusive in the abstract discourse thus far, as Mark was indicating, but we really are going to get activism here. Three, they all depend on cooperative enterprises, and I think that's a lot of what we maybe will be talking about, a cooperation that transcends the individual aesthetic or ideology. Four, they sit in relationship to other contemporary activist agendas that test and threaten neoliberal culture industry, accelerationism, localism, neofeminism, do-it-yourselfism, and forms of object-oriented ontology. I say sit in relationship to, not because they all adhere in any way to any one of these things, but it definitely forms an intellectual context within which they establish positions. And five, I think they together form an alternate example of aesthetic activism than the three that we have heard over the course of the last day and a half, those three being the one that is delineated by Elaine Scarry, that defined by transformational notions of beauty, another one defined by object-oriented ontology with a kind of charismatic but withdrawn object, and then the one defined by Jacques Rancière, which implies a pre-existent aesthetic that pre-exists a kind of political thought process or identity. In each of these three, there is an implicit or explicit dismissal of activism that merely protests, that merely identifies a problem and doesn't ask for a new attitude that has fundamental change either in its ontological position or in its economic political position, which is to say the work in this session clearly does not adhere to the problem of protest, of activism that is trying to elucidate problems in our existing culture. I'm going to press this observation in the discussion, but I want to just say that what really unites these positions is their commitment to the future. And that commitment to the future is a stance that makes the dichotomy between what we might call mere protest or mere criticism or mere exposure to a problem, that on the one hand, an actual change, much harder to delineate. So let me first introduce our first speaker for this session. Nettrice Gaskin earned her BFA in computer graphics with honors from Pratt Institute in 1992 and an MFA in art and technology from the School of the Art of Chicago in 1994. She worked for several years in K through 12 and post-secondary education, community media, and technology before enrolling in Georgia Tech, where she received her PhD in digital media in 2014. Her model for techno-vernacular creativity investigates its characteristics and applicability to STEAM, which is science, technology, engineering, art, and mathematics. She blogs for the producer of the Peabody Award-winning PBS series Art in the 21st Century and published in Ghost Nature. Her essays are in Meet Me at the Fair, A World's Fair Reader, Future Texts, Subversive Performance and Feminist Bodies, and Afro-Futurism 2.1, The Rise of Astro-Blackness. She is currently the director of the STEAM Lab at Boston Arts Academy. Nettrice presented Black Futurism at We Are City 2014 in Indianapolis, Cybism and Decoding the Letter at ISEA 2011 in Istanbul, and co-facilitated augmented reality and open spaces at ISEA 2012 in Albuquerque, New Mexico. She moderated Enlightenment, Strange Mathematics, and Rhythmic Equations at the Studio Museum in Harlem in 2014. She was a digital STEAM research intern at the Smithsonian Institute in 2013 and received funding from the National Science Foundation for Advancing STEM Through Cultural Situations, Art-Based Learning in 2014. Please welcome Nettrice.
Good morning. So I'm going to start with a quote from on the functional model for aesthetic response by Daniel Conrad. Okay. In both art and nature, beauty always displays a provocative, often novel, pattern or structure. It provokes ways of perceiving the structure, transforming it to extract something significant. The act of transformation is essential to the experience. Culture is the totality of socially transmitted patterns, art, beliefs, institutions, and all other products of human work. Aesthetics is what is considered by members of a culture artistically to be valuable or beautiful. Consider the cosmogram, which served as an emblematic representation of the Bakongo people in West Central Africa, and summarized the broad array of ideas and metaphoric messages that compose their sense of identity within the cosmos. This design consists of a simple cross with one line representing the boundary between the living world and that of the dead, and the other representing the path of power from below to above, as well as the vertical path across the boundary. The Congo cosmogram existed as a long-standing symbolic tradition within the Bakongo culture before European contact in 1482, and that it continued in use through the early 20th century. Within its design, the Congo cosmogram contains mirrored worlds within the spiritual journey of the sun, and it connected with the funerary ceremonies and the end of life. Here, African cosmology merges with Afrofuturism, an aesthetic that combines elements of science and historical fiction, fantasy, Afrocentricity, and magic realism with non-Western cosmologies in order to critique not only the present-day dilemmas of Black people, but also to revise, interrogate, and re-examine the historical events of the past. Thus, the cosmogram, perhaps a much lesser-known representation of the cosmos in Afrofuturism, is a subject that will be explored here. In the Congo cosmogram, the universe is divided, let me go back real quick for that, into two parts, with the relationship of the land of the dead and the world and the physical world. A body of water represented by the Kalunga, a water line, which is seen as a passage and barrier, separates these two worlds. Kalunga is the rupture or break that exists between spaces, transporting people to worlds of their imagination. This map visualizes the concept of ritual and movement, as well as newly established spaces that transform identities and communities. In the basement floor at the First African Baptist Church in Savannah, Georgia, which is well into its third century and one of the oldest Black churches in the United States, there is a space that is 4 feet tall and held hundreds of enslaved Africans following the Savannah River to freedom. Builders punctured holes in the floor in the cross and diamond shape of an African prayer symbol, the Congo cosmogram, and publicly worshiped its ancient meaning. Quietly, underneath, the escapees worshiped the light and aired the symbols aloud. The Congo cosmogram is fractal, cyclic, and self-regenerating. It is eternal and infinite. Certain elements of its design prevail in the ring shout, the oldest continuously practiced African-derived dance in the United States that is still performed today. The ring shout is an ecstatic, transcendent religious ritual in which worshipers dance counterclockwise in a circle while shuffling and stomping their feet and clapping their hands. The worshipers sing their own improvised hymns called shouts in a call and response format, often pantomiming actions described in the songs. This performance suggests movement around the Congo cosmogram. So I'm going to read a quote by Nelson George about a formation that sort of came from the ring shout, which is freestyle b-boying and hip hop, or breaking. Each person's turn in the ring was very brief, 10 to 30 seconds, but packed with action and meaning. Acrobatic transitions such as head spins, hand spins, shoulder spins, flips, and the swipe. A flip of the weight from the hands to the feet that also involves a twist in the body's direction served as bridges between the footwork and the freeze. The final element was the exit, a spring back to the verticality or the special movement that returned the dancer to the outside of the circle. Cosmograms have been elaborated upon across the African diaspora, showing complex, intricate patterns or simplified into abbreviated X's or even V's, implying the arc of travel or motion. Watching these dancers reveals the circular, spiraling movements that replicate the Congo cosmogram. This replication is what artist Sanford Biggers calls an aesthetic echo. The aesthetic response in this instance embraces improvisation and exists as a call and response, as a form of call and response, which is a pervasive pattern of participation that includes the spontaneous of verbal and nonverbal interaction between speaker and listeners or listener, in which calls or statements from the speaker are emphasized by expressions or responses from the listeners. And so you can see here, this is actually a diagram, just kind of pointing that out. You see this motif again and again. Circularity pervades West African ideology, and the circle has proved equally important. Moreover, the watery barrier or kalunga, which separates the corporal and spirit worlds of the Congo cosmogram, has also found a weighty role in African-American ideology. This design has resonance. The ring shout has evolved to include countless other formations, including freestyle breakdance and rap ciphers and hip-hop and expressions that represent the universe. These examples provoke modes of perception and interaction, with the cosmogram serving as a moderator between different positions or states in space and time. So Harvard humanities professor Hamni Baba, this quote is from a book on location of culture. And he says it becomes critical to distinguish between the semblance and similitude of the symbols across diverse cultural experiences, literature, art, music, ritual, life, and death, and the social specificity of each of these productions as meaning as they circulate as signs within specific contextual locations and social systems of value. The transnational dimension of cultural transformation, migration, diaspora, displacement, relocation, makes the process of cultural translation a complex form of signification. All perception requires transformations. When we see, we filter out noise, fill in gaps, connect dots, rotate, stretch, and juxtapose. Perception is creative. Different minds interpret similar input differently. The cosmogram triggers an aesthetic response that mediates perception and interpretation, and in certain manifestations, transcendent ritual. It exists as a mechanism for aesthetic response, positioning the observer of an event here within the moment of now as an interactive part of creation. This cultural model frequently appears in Afrofuturism, an aesthetic that navigates past, present, and future simultaneously. Afrofuturism is ever expanding, revealing a universe that reaches beyond the speculative and includes the orbits of many spheres, including the arts, humanities, and technology and science. Considering the early West African emphasis on circularity and water spirits, and the influence of a Bakongo cosmology and ritual across the African diaspora, it should not be surprising that certain aspects of Afrofuturism would share these same characteristics. Afrofuturist work in what post-colonial scholar and theorist Hamni Baba would refer to as a third space of enunciation or expression in which cultural systems are constructed, which includes embedded myths, the construction of culture, and the invention of tradition. Baba's third space theory explains the uniqueness of people or contexts as hybrids, the cosmos, the cross, and water as vehicles for transformation, each define a third space in the Congo cosmogram. They are found in Afrofuturist music as well. Mississippi blues musician Robert Johnson's early death gave rise to the Faustian myth that he sold his soul to the devil at the crossroads to achieve fame. Afrofuturism pioneer and jazz maverick Sun Ra, who like Johnson came from the Deep South, was part of the great migration of African Americans from the southern part of the United States to the Northeast, Midwest, and West between 1910 and 1970. Sun Ra brought with him many aspects of Black cultural production, such as improvisation and otherworldly mythology. Sun Ra's music coalesced in Chicago in the mid-1950s when he and the orchestra used Afrocentric and space-themed titles to reflect Sun Ra's linkage of ancient African culture and the cutting edge of the space age. In Congo cosmology, water is the imaginary boundary between the world of the living and the dead. It separates us from the land of the ancestors, but also provides a passage to it. Drexia, an electronic music duo from Detroit, established an origin myth based on the Middle Passage, the route for ships carrying enslaved African people from one geographical location to another across the Atlantic Ocean. Drexia, according to the duo, was an underwater country populated by the unborn children of pregnant African women thrown off of slave ships who had learned to breathe underwater in their mother's wombs. Drexia is a sonic rupture that exists between geographies, and especially Africa and the Americas, that transports listeners to a bubble metropolis where the ocean floor is home to the webbed mutants of the Black Atlantic. Drexia's first album release, The Quest, included inner sleeve liner notes with a map that illustrates their origin mythology and is divided into four stages: the slave trade, migration route of rural Blacks to northern cities, which features a cosmogram, techno leaves Detroit and spreads worldwide, and the journey home or future. And so there's a quote, and this is regarding the album and regarding the philosophy or mythology of Drexia. In Africa, thousands of years ago, high-tech nomads began to emerge from a dimensional jump hole. To those that know, Drexia has left their mark all over the world, including in a subterranean city deep in the ocean floor, where Africans were brought to when they were thrown off slave ships. We can imagine Drexia as the aqua zone that surrounds an isolated isolated island somewhere in the Black Atlantic, with dimensional portals to Africa, North America, Europe, and beyond Earth. These oceanic islands of music technology are separated from our physical reality. Drexia's fictionalized frequencies exist in a dimension beyond the known, providing a passage for a dispersed people, connecting them to a homeland. This portal allows for a speedy travel between sonic coordinates. Another example that reveals the cosmogram is, as a third space, is the short film Till the Quiet Comes by director Khalil Joseph. Within this film, Joseph joins the practitioners of Afrofuturism who harness the speculative mold and African diaspora spirituality and mythologies to represent Black people's old and new world experiences. The film is based on the song of the same name by Flying Lotus, who is the nephew of Alice Coltrane and John Coltrane, and presents several elements of the Congo cosmogram, such as the watery boundary of Kalunga and the crossroads. The ghost dance you see in the video of a murdered African-American youth reveals the third space of its design. At the end of the film, the ghost dancer is carried off to a land of the ancestors and perhaps to a future rebirth. This is a video to play. Take a second. It's linked to the slide. So while we're waiting for the video to pop up, this is a screenshot from the video. And yeah, here it comes. Okay, someone hit play, please.
Dream of love and light and laughter, love.
Yeah, you can stop it. I'm just going to wrap up the talk. And back to the slides for a quick moment. Representations of the Congo cosmogram are helpful ways to understand the cultural production in Afrofuturism. However, this is just the beginning of the journey into the myriad spatialities where the themes reimagine many cultural, scientific, and technological concepts. The dimensional jump holder Africa and back is a portal between known worlds into a hybrid reality of technocultural aquazone. This threshold brings us John Coltrane's Giant Steps, Houston Conwell's Rivers, Zenobia Bailey's Paradise Under the Reconstruction of the Aesthetic of Funk, and Saya Woolfolk's Chima Tech. John Basquiat's King Alfonso is a distinct example of the cosmogram in plain sight, acting like the head of an arrow on the right side of the canvas. The technical diagram aspect of Basquiat's painting suggests a transition or change from one place or system to another. Within this domain, the aesthetic response as improvisation through call and response, participation, repetition, and the deliberate fracture or disruption of typical rhythms and patterns to create new arrangements. Cosmogramic design elements such as the circle, the cross, and a rupture of the middle passage produce a dimensional jump pose across space and time through which artists and performers move from one state of reality to the next. It is this design that triggers the aesthetic response and aesthetic experience in its practitioners and in the audiences that are immersed in their works. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Our second speaker is Diann Bauer. She's an artist and a writer based in London and founding member of the writing collective Laboria Kubnix, which introduced the Xenofeminism movement into the contemporary discourse. Her work spans a range of disciplines and has been screened and exhibited internationally in London at the Tate Britain, the Showroom and the Drawing Room, in Athens at Deste Foundation and Banaki Museum, in Melbourne at Ian Potter Museum of Art, in Berlin at Kraupau Toscani Zeidler and Inouye Akshan Gallery, and in New York at the New Museum, White Box, the Dorsky Museum, OMI International Arts Center, and Socrates Sculpture Park. Bauer is involved in several collaborative projects, including the above-mentioned Laboria Kubnix, with whom she wrote and published Xenofeminism, A Politics for Alienation in 2015, a working group that's redefined by feminism adequate to the global 21st century. She works in the Office of Applied Complexity, a platform for research and development that traverses conceptual terrains and with an aim to construct new models for work between art, science, technology, and power. She has passed AST, which is to say the Alliance of Southern Triangle, a collaboration with two architects. She actually studied architecture at Cooper Union, and a curator in Miami developing interdisciplinary projects that address global climate change, cities, real estate development, taxation, insurance schemes, terraforming, statecraft, and art. Please welcome Diann.
Hi. Good morning. Thanks very much both for the invitation to be here. It's really exciting for me personally to be here. And also thank you to you all for coming out and giving up your lion to be here, giving up your sleep on a Saturday morning. So the talk is called Xenotemporal Futures. And I have a lot I want to get through, so I'm just going to jump straight in. So an orientation towards the future as a project has recently been reclaimed by a political left under the name of Xenofeminism, which I will often refer to as XF throughout the talk. It encompasses aspects of both left accelerationism and Prometheanism. It is within this context that I am developing the idea of xenotemporality. And with this paper, I'll begin to sketch out what this could mean and why it's needed. My commitment to a myriad of projects that uphold the idea of the future as their guiding principle made evident the idea to ask the need to ask some fundamental questions about time. The idea of xenotemporality comes out of the type of alienation spoke about and written in a text written by Laboria Cubonics in 2015 called Xenofeminism, A Politics for Alienation. I'll show a short video in a few minutes to give a sense both of Laboria Cubonics and the XF project. But to clarify what I mean by xenotemporality, it is based on the idea that the primacy of human phenomenology, the human phenomenological experience of time, is no longer sufficient to how we organize, inflect, and orient the systems we have created, because these systems function on scales that are well beyond the experiential capacity of the human. The development of xenotemporality, or an alien time, that at once is outside of our experience of time, but accessible via thought, and in turn via our technosocial complexity, will help frame how we think, how we are to think about, but also utilize the shifting understanding of what time is and how it functions for the human. I just want to lay out what I mean by a few terms that I'm going to be using here. So I realize that a lot of you will be familiar with the discourse around accelerationism, and some less so. But even within the established discourse, there's some contention about meaning, so I want to briefly clarify what I'm talking about when I speak about accelerationism, Prometheanism, and xenofeminism. So to begin with accelerationism, it's often understood to mean the speeding up of capital's trajectories as a means to hasten its collapse. Capitalism will spin away faster and faster until no longer functions and something else will come about. And this is not the version that XF avows. Rather, I can briefly sketch it out as this. Left accelerationism is the building of a politics based on the recognition that while the world is more complex than ever before, we also have the capacity to act in and on this complexity in unprecedented ways. Through technology, we have the capacity to operate on greater and more de-individuated scales, enabling real traction on this complexity. The aim of left accelerationism is the long game of developing a post-capitalist future, given the realities of where we are now, through a deliberate reorienting of forces across a range of fields. The term indeed has become rather contentious. The Manifesto for Accelerationist Politics by Nick Cernicek and Alex Williams lays out some of the ideas in manifesto form, and it was followed by their 2015 book, Inventing the Future, where they did drop the term accelerationism because of the confusion and association with the version that avows simply accelerating capital. I will still use the term for now, but I just wanted to be clear which side of it I come down on. XF encompasses the kind of left accelerationism by recognizing the scale on which we must think, but in addition makes explicit the need for decoupling any building of future platforms from centuries of habituated injustice and miserable imbalances of power that exist around race, gender, and economic standing. The need for the future to be constructed, and indeed that the future can be constructed, is a foundation for XF, and this is its Prometheanism. To clarify how I use this term, I will quote Ray Brazier from his essay, Prometheanism and Its Critics, where he says, Prometheanism is an attempt to participate in the creation of a world without having to defer to a divine blueprint. It follows from the realization that the disequilibrium we introduce into the world through through our desire to know, is no more or less objectionable than the disequilibrium that is already in the world, unquote. This is to say that there's not some given that needs to be respected or maintained. XF is opposed to essentialism, that, for example, men are like this and women are like that. Rather, it is through an alienation from some purported natural state of things, while still understanding the human and its technology as part of an evolutionary process, that we are able to construct conditions, systems, and discrete parts of what our world is, how it functions, and what it will become. So to summarize briefly, before I do go to the video break, I just want to give you a sense of what the project is. It's a left accelerationist, Promethean, non-identitarian feminism. I will show a very short video. It's only about 4 minutes. It's a little bit of an onslaught for first thing on a Saturday morning, so I apologize for that in advance if you're a little hungover. So if you could just play the video, that would be great. Thanks. Let me grab a water. Thank you. So XF is a project that recognizes that a retreat to small-scale tactics and localized politics are insufficient as solutions given the scale of the problems and how we operate as a species. This is not to say that the work done on the local scale is not important, but XF is a project whose focus, rather, is on systemic conditions. It is at this point primarily a discursive project, and for me also an aesthetic one. XF now recognizes the possibilities of reorientation towards broader social justice are created by the complex systems in which we live and not despite them. Xenofeminism Politics for Alienation as a text covers a lot of ground that I will not speak about today. Rather, I will focus on what is meant by productive alienation and how the form of alienation we propose could provide an armature on which to develop further thinking about how to build a future, specifically with regard to our relationship to the very condition of futurity, which is the reality of time. So in the text, we say the following. XF seizes alienation as an impetus to generate new worlds. We are all alienated, but have we been otherwise? It is through and not despite our alienated condition that we can free ourselves from the muck of immediacy. Freedom is not a given, and is certainly not by given anything natural. The construction of freedom involves not less but more alienation. Alienation is the labor of freedom's construction. Nothing should be accepted as fixed, permanent, or given, neither material conditions nor social forms. So what do we mean by alienation? There are risks in using this term, attempting to reclaim and in some ways redefine a word that has so much weight both in political history of both in the history of political thought as well as in common parlance is no small task, though as we mentioned, XF is a project that is not short on ambition. There are risks of miscommunication and misunderstanding, and this paper is in part an attempt to clarify some of the ways which we're using the term, how it is to be understood in the context of XF, and to speculate on where this meaning might lead. So, first of all, it's a relational term. Something or someone is alienated from something or someone else. We are all alienated, have we been otherwise? The argument is that as long as we have been sapient, we have been alienated. I'm making a distinction here between sapience and sentience, and I take this again from Brazier, who takes it from Wilfred Sellers, who I think Harman mentioned yesterday. I'm using sapience to mean the human ability to use reason to both reflect and consciously act on her world, and by extension, to construct it, while the sentient being is one that has awareness of their surroundings, but not necessarily the capacity to deliberately reflect and act on it. As we evolved out of the muck of immediacy, be this in our evolution as a species through time, or the muck of immediacy of daily, everyday demands of being a bit of sentient biology. If given basic conditions, we can do much more than obtain food, shelter, and reproduce. As soon as we could reason beyond our biological needs and reflect on our finitude, we were already alienated. But it is this condition that enables us to plan and plot and discern it ought to be like this for these reasons. It is this form of alienation that has enabled the species to be as successful as it currently is. And when I say successful here, I'm not making a moral judgment. I just mean our dominance as a species and the ability to avoid extinction, as well as to do some rather amazing things, space travel or antibiotics, for example. So on a broad scale, at the scale of the species, alienation from our biology via sapience is a productive force. The ability as a species to self-reflect and in turn make and remake what we are, what is human, is one of the ways XF avows alienation. There are, however, other forms of alienation that I want to be clear about. Individual alienation can also be productive. There are indeed many examples of individuals that have used personal, social, or economic alienation to create the new, to create something better than that wasn't there or even needed previously. And though this alienation on this scale can be productive, it is not the kind XF should avow programmatically. Not everyone gets to be the hero that fought the odds. The more common result of this kind of alienation is a slow and grinding dissolve of individual political agency. People do not get broken because they are not strong or not heroic enough. They get broken because of a systemic stacking of the cards. In this context, people succeed despite their alienation and not because of it. It's important to be clear about what kind of alienation we are avowing, how and where and on what scale it functions. XF is not a project that avows allowing things to get so bad that they will have to get better. Those who suffer most under this sort of logic are often those who are already screwed. So while we as a species have the capacity for reason and the capacity to make what ought to be, we also have the capacity to construct truly catastrophic conditions that can always exceed our imagination for how bad things can get. So to turn to the kind of alienation that I am interested in pursuing, how does this alienation as a species from some purported given in nature begin to be constructive as a project? For this, I return to the original title of the talk, Xenotemporal Futures. If the bulk of what I do as an artist involves participation in future-oriented projects, either the more discursive XF, which I've been speaking about, or the more practice-based project called AST, which Peggy mentioned in her introduction, the Alliance of the Southern Triangle, which I won't have time to speak about here in detail, but briefly, it's a collaborative involving myself, a curator, and two Miami-based architects developing interdisciplinary projects that address global climate change, cities, real estate development, taxation, insurance schemes, terraforming, statecraft, and art. My point for the purposes of this paper is broadly speaking, my practice is future-oriented. And because of this, it seems important to think about this, what the actual, this thing called the future is. So an important question for me here is time. How can we better understand it, both ontologically and epistemologically? Indeed, what are the conditions for thinking the future? So some of the questions I have around time are, what sort of temporal scales must we think and function on, given how we now operate as a species? Is an understanding of time based on individual phenomenological experience of it a sufficient guide when trying to imagine a future that can be otherwise? And will our relationship to time, I mean what we understand time to be ontologically, not temporal experience, will this fundamentally shift because what we have evolved into as a species with regard to how we operate in and as global, complex global systems? Does it need to, and has it already happened? Time, both phenomenological as well as objective time, are the conditions in which we function and, of course, always have been. But the way we operate now as a species shifts our evolutionary needs to understand non-experiential time. The better we are able to think time, the more equipped we will be to deliberately orient our complexity towards more just and emancipatory trajectories. So this is where we return to the productivity of alienation. If we are to impact or orient complex systems that are of our own making but function beyond individual experience, the alienation between knowing and the complete vertigo-inducing humility of what we do not yet know, or perhaps cannot know, needs to be utilized as a productive force. The individual experience of complex system is not the thing that enables comprehension of them. Armin Avanasian and Suhail Malik have recently been working on an idea they call the speculative time complex. In a conversation between them, recently published by Name Publications, Malik says this: "The main reason for speculative reorganization of time is the complexity and scale of social organization today. Systems, infrastructures, and networks are now the leading condition of complex societies rather than individual human agents. Correspondingly, human experience loses its primacy, as do the semantics and politics based on it." So a good example of this is GPS. GPS uses some of the realities of time outside of human experience, the need to compensate for the effects of gravity on time, to function accurately. To give some explanation of this, I quote physicist Clifford M. Will, who says that atomic clocks on board the satellites that control GPS, quote, experience gravity that is 4 times weaker than that on the ground. Einstein's general relativity theory says that gravity curves space and time, resulting in a tendency for the orbiting clocks to tick slightly faster, unquote. We, of course, have no perception of this difference in rate of flow, not just because we are in one place relative to the source, i.e. down here, but because it's too small of a difference to be felt. Evolutionarily speaking, our own perception of time has no need to perceive the relationship between gravity and time's flow. But its effects, because of the systems we have constructed, and I would argue are now part of what we are and what we are evolving into, there is a need to perceive these effects, to program for them. But the evolving human, qua our technology, also creates a feedback loop. So this is a question of actually where this alienation between being and knowing might take us. The example of GPS also points to possibilities for expanding our knowing, expands our capacity of what it means to see our universe. I'm going to end with a rather long quote from Jeff Manaw's Bilderblog. He went to visit the headquarters of GPS, i.e. the Masters of Space, at Schriver Air Force Base in Colorado, and this is what he found. Edge to edge, the GPS constellation can apparently be considered something of a single device, a massive superdetector whose time glitches could be analyzed for signs of dark matter. He quotes The New Scientist saying, the network of satellites is about 50,000 kilometers in diameter and is traveling through space along with the entire solar system at about 300 kilometers a second. So any time shift when the solar system passes through a cosmic kink will take a maximum of 170 seconds to move across the network. The temporal distortion, a kind of space-time wave, would propagate across the constellation, taking as long as 170 seconds to pass from one side to the other, leaving forensically visible traces in GPS navigational timestamps. Now, actually, the article goes on to talk about how this shows up forensically within the built environment. I'm not going to talk about that, but it's actually worth looking at because it ends up very interesting results. He goes on to say, the very idea of a 50,000 kilometer wide super device barreling through cosmic kinks in space-time is already mind-bogglingly awesome, but add to this the fact that the device is actually an artificial constellation run by the US military, and it is as if we are all living inside an immense, semi-weaponized, three-dimensional space-time instrument. Those same cosmic kinks could theoretically show up as otherwise imperceptible moments of location error on your smartphone. This would thus enlist you, against your knowledge, as a minor relay point in a dark matter detector larger than the planet Earth. So, just to finish, we are already alien to so much of the non-sapient universe. This alienation already exists and is worth avowing. It'll mean our evolution is expedited, our capacities as a species expanded. What it is to be human is shifting, as it always has, but now, perhaps ironically, at a pace we can witness in a lifetime. Our capacity for thinking what ought to be needs to be foundationally and genetically woven into the project, and old habits of inequality rhetoricized as nature or the natural state of things that is somehow worth preserving needs to be dissolved. As some feminists have asserted for a long time, and XF continues to, there is no state of things that cannot be shifted. Thanks.
Thank you so much.
Our last speaker is Catherine Flood. Catherine Flood is a curator of posters and graphic art at the Victoria and Albert Museum in London. Her recent show, Disobedient Objects, of 2015 and 16, explored the material culture of radical change and protest, from objects familiar, such as banners and posters, to the more militant, cunning, and technologically cutting edge, including lock-ons, book blocks, and activist robots. Where previous social movement histories have focused on large-scale events, strategies, or biographies, her curatorial work shows how objects themselves can be revolutionary. With co-curator Gavin Grinden, one of the few historians who works on art and activism, she started talking about whether it was possible to source this disobedient material. Disobedient not just in form, but in content, and present it in a rigorous way. The exhibition was an enormous critical and popular success, one of the best attended at the V&A. As one critic wrote, not only the subject matter, but the curatorial process behind Disobedient Objects reflects an episode of broad institutional soul-searching by the V&A, which, among other things, has led to an updating of the museum's 19th century object categorization structure. Indeed, what made the exhibition more than just the sum of its disobedient objects was the disobedient way that it understood these objects, not as dead artifacts, but as objects whose life they continue by giving instructions of how to make them in the future by yourself for other purposes. In addition, it also is an indication of a redefinition of curatorship. As the curators wrote, the experts in this area weren't curators or academics, but the people who are making these objects. Please welcome Catherine.
Thank you. Firstly, it's a real pleasure to be here, so thank you to Mark for inviting me. Disobedient Objects was an exhibition I co-curated with Gavin Grindon in 2014 at the V&A about the art and design of grassroots social movements over the last 35 years, a period during which creative forms of activism have proliferated within social movements. The objects we showed are disobedient in two senses. They play a role in carrying out acts of political disobedience. We can think about them as prosthetics that extend people's ability to act politically. But they're also disobedient in the context of the museum, in that they challenge the aesthetic regime of the institution in ways that I think are productive. And before going on, I want to give you a quick idea of the content and show you a few examples of these disobedient objects. So we've got apieras from Chile, textiles sewn by women as a form of organizing and also to document the atrocities under the Pinochet regime. There's Phone Story, which is a video game to play on your smartphone that critiques the making of that device. And here you're in the coltan mines and you're the soldier having to make the children work faster. There's the Tiki Love Truck, which was a mosaic pickup truck, an anti-death penalty statement that incorporates the death mask of John Joe Amador, a man who was executed by the state of Texas in 2007. There's an inflatable General Assembly by Common Practice, made as part of the Occupy movement, designed for Zuccotti Park, and the idea that you can create a spontaneous structure that facilitates a new kind of decision-making. There's a graffiti writing robot that allows you to keep a safe distance from your active graffiti, made by the Institute of Applied Autonomy, who develop technologies for protesters. They see themselves as the kind of alternative to the branch of the US military that develop weapons. There's a gay rights placard that was carried in the demonstrations in Moscow against the re-election of Putin. And it says, "Putin, we won't give it to you a third time." But it was the first time the rainbow flag was carried on the streets of Russia. And there's a slingshot made from a child's shoe used in Palestine in 2001. There are many ways in which art and design can be politically active, but our focus in Disobedient Objects was on the often unacknowledged grassroots cultures of activist social movements, tools produced very often collectively in the course of a struggle rather than studio or gallery-based practices. The premise of the exhibition was that this material deserves our attention. Many of the rights and liberties we enjoy today have been won by movements, and objects have played a role in those struggles. And yet they're largely ignored and excluded by museums and institutions of art and design. Although they may seem chaotic and irregular when viewed from the outside, social movements are important producers of both politics and culture, introducing new ways of seeing the world and relating to each other that are later taken for granted. And incidentally, since we're in a school of architecture, this interest in paying attention to this material as a design curator can be paralleled by two architectural collectives, Occupy Gezi Architecture and Bureau A, who both documented the spontaneous built structures of protest camps in Istanbul and Kiev, arguing that these grassroots forms of architecture could change definitions of architecture to provide new definitions, a kind of horizontal bigness that kind of spreads out over occupied city squares as a sort of pose to the kind of traditional vertical bigness of skyscrapers and Olympic parks that isn't that's out of reach to many people. But returning to the museum, there was an element of institutional critique at the heart of the Disobedient Objects project. The question of what museums collect and what they don't collect and why. And for me as a curator, it was an opportunity to question many of the assumptions about how we judge success in art and design and the ways in which we represent objects within the museum. The culture of the museum is in many ways antithetical to the culture of social movements. Since most of these objects don't exist within the within museum collections, we borrowed them directly from the people who made them. And most of those who participated in the exhibition initially had major reservations about what it would mean to put their objects in the V&A, a museum built at the height of the colonial project, an institution that represents the establishment. In the 19th century, it was even claimed that museums could prevent riots and sedition, as well as drunkenness, by using up the leisure time of the working classes. What happens when you put disobedient objects at the heart of a building that was conceived for such obedient purposes? So we began with a double-edged question: what would disobedient objects do to the museum, and what would the museum do to disobedient objects? History is inevitably a matter of selective inclusion. Michael Frisch puts it very bluntly in terms that make me think of the Imperial Museum. Why bother with history when you're rich and powerful? All it can do is tell you how you climbed to the top, which is a story probably better not to examine too closely. You don't need history. What you need is something more like a pretty carpet that can be rolled out on ceremonial occasions to cover all those bloodstains on the stairs. Museums have traditionally been part of this project of telling history from above. There's a long-standing critique of the modern museum that it selects objects and fixes their meaning into an agreed and linear view of the universe that serves to normalize the status quo. Disobedient objects are objects that tell a different history of making, objects that disclose hidden moments in which, if only in brief flashes, we find the possibility that things might be otherwise, that in fact the world might also be made from below by collective, organized disobedience away against the way things are. And the images here show an installation by activist ceramicist Carrie Reichart and the Treatment Rooms Collective that subverted the monumental facade of the V&A building during the exhibition, and panels that dedicate the building to Queen Victoria, Empress of India, were covered over by two mosaics that addressed this idea of the power of telling history from below. And quotations from historical activists were tiled between the steps leading up to the entrance. Museums of art and design have aesthetic criteria for including and excluding objects that reflect privileged social conditions. The V&A is full of highly finished examples of high craft, mostly produced for elite and private consumption. The making of such objects has usually involved resources of time and capital and some form of governance in the form of institutional training or patronage. Social movements produce objects under very different conditions, quickly and often under pressure and duress, with few resources of time and money, by reappropriating everyday materials. Such objects are often considered and beautiful solutions to complex problems, but they are necessarily rough and raw in their making. And set alongside the kinds of objects typically encountered within the V&A, they can appear to be failures when judged on predetermined criteria of technical excellence. But we could turn the question around. For the very reasons just outlined, finely made objects are mostly failures in the task of making social change. A failure to pass the museum test can be a form of disobedience in its own right, not least in questioning narrow grounds of quality. And this is an example of what Judith Havelstam calls the queer art of failure, where failure becomes a form of critique by refusing to acquiesce in dominant logics of power and discipline. Within the museum, a particular idea of aesthetic excellence is reproduced through the connoisseurship of an object's formal qualities and the idea of the artist's hand, in which the materiality of the object, stripped of context, takes precedence over other ways of thinking about it. A standard museum label concentrates on what we call the tombstone information, the name of the person who made the work, the medium, the technique, the style, the place it was made. And so in terms of what Graham Harmon was talking about yesterday, in museums, we're very good at undermining objects, concentrating on what the object is rather than on what it does. And such an approach is self-perpetuating. The V&A's collections, for example, are organized into departments based on materials and techniques, paintings, woodwork, textiles, etc., which by turn then organize how curators are trained. But disobedient objects demand different criteria. Each movement has its own aesthetic composition, and the objects emerging from these cultures can't be neatly categorized by styles and types. They don't kind of fit into the aesthetic structure of the museum. They can be made by highly skilled artists, craftspeople, and technologists, but the purpose is not to create art for art's sake or to demonstrate mastery of a particular medium, but to solve a particular social problem. While medium is a defining category for the traditional artist, for makers of disobedient objects, medium is contingent. They work by any media necessary, with whatever tools and skills are to hand to address the situation. Frustrated by the state of criticism when it comes to political art, Stephen Duncombe and Steve Lambert, co-directors of the Centre of Artistic Activism, wrote an open letter to critics writing about political art in 2012, suggesting that we need to develop new vocabulary and criteria capable of evaluating political art and activist artists. The first question they suggest to ask of political art is, does it work? We don't mean does it work aesthetically, but does it work politically? This is not to balance aesthetic quality against social significance, but to begin to rethink aesthetic value itself. In 1968, when French students set up the Atelier Populaire in Paris to print posters in support of the anti-government strikes and demonstrations, they were adamant that the kind of art they were producing could not be viewed within a museum. They issued a statement declaring that the posters of the Atelier Populaire are weapons in the service of the struggle and are an inseparable part of it. To display them in bourgeois places of culture, to consider them as objects of aesthetic interest, is to impair both their function and their effect. The position of an outside observer is a fiction that inevitably plays into the hands of the ruling class. That is why these works should not be taken as the final outcome of an experience. So we could say that the posters of the Atelier Populaire are unfinished in two senses. The rough surface of the posters reveals the contingent conditions of their making, the cheap newsprint paper, the simple-to-print monochrome design, and the fingerprints where the sheet was torn urgently from the screen. But as the quotation reminds us, they are unfinished in another, more teleological sense. They are tools in the struggle, not the final outcome of an experience. Only their context of use makes such objects whole. Their aesthetic cannot be separated from their context. And I'm going to give a couple of examples of that. In some cases, the creative act lies not in making an object, but in breaking one, in reappropriating an existing object and turning it to a new disobedient purpose. This is a battered plan lid used in the Cacarizales protests in Argentina in 2001, where the government froze the bank accounts of 18 million citizens. People turned out in the streets in mass demonstrations and carried archetypal objects of domestic design, saucepans, out into the street for noise-making protests. And in this case, the political context is completely redefined. Sorry, the political context of use has completely redefined the meaning around the object. The saucepan in Argentina can never quite be the same again. It has unlocked a new latent potential. The monument to the Cacarizales protest, seen here on the right hand of the slide, warns government officials, beware civil servants, for the saucepan is watching you. Disobedient objects are often appropriated. Well, while disobedient objects are often appropriated, they also appropriate their context of existing architectural situations. For example, the giant inflatable cobblestones made by the group Tools for Action for protesters to throw at the police lines during street demonstrations in a protest they call tactical frivolity. The cobblestones work by drawing the police into a surreal performance. Not knowing what to do with the inflatables, the police either toss them back to the protesters, turning the situation into a strange kind of ball game, or they flounder around trying to attack them. Either way, their image of order and authority, which is very important to the police, is destroyed. And I'll, if we could play the video, you can see that in action.
The city to shut down.
Get the idea. The aesthetic impact of the cobblestones is not the cobblestones themselves, but the situation they create and the image they produce of the police. A few years ago, a handbook for creative activism was published titled Beautiful Trouble, suggesting that it's making trouble rather than making objects that is the aesthetic practice. But I also think that the makeshift, almost daft aesthetic of the inflatable cobblestones becomes empowering. In street protests, there's an unequal balance between the power of the protesters and the police. The police have all the power and equipment. And yet, with imagination and a bit of shiny silver foil, the protesters can wrong foot a far greater power, at least temporarily. It's a kind of asymmetrical technical innovation, and maybe relates a bit to what Timothy Morton was talking about yesterday about finding wiggle room. Disobedient objects operate as part of ecologies composed of other objects, music, performing bodies, technology, laws, organizations, and effects. They're embedded in the world, and unlike the museum, the world is messy and it has lots of moving parts. The problem of transferring these objects into the museum space is that they become isolated from their ecologies. The Atelier Populaire statement voices a critique of the museum that continues to resonate with social movements today. There's the argument that capitalism turns everything into a spectacle or a commodity. Within the museum, stripped of context, objects are easily fetishized and turned from tools of action to objects of aesthetic contemplation and perversely entertainment. Lenders to the exhibition were concerned that the museum would appropriate and recuperate the authenticity and vitality of their objects, creaming off the cultural capital for its own ends. To move away from this model in which the museum encloses objects, we worked collaboratively with lenders and participants in social movements, seeking to reconceptualize the boundary of the institution as something more permeable. Through a series of roundtable discussions, workshops, and ongoing conversations with lenders, we tried to work out what it would mean to represent these objects on their own terms, to be with and for them, rather than imposing existing museum disciplines and templates. And we sort of went back to the etymological root of the word curator as someone who cares, and what would it mean to actually care about these objects. And we were partly inspired by the anthropological methodology of participatory action research, where you don't carry out research on people, you research with them. You allow them to define some of the research questions, and some of the benefit of that research should accrue back to them. But this meant rethinking everything from how to structure the exhibition to its design to the vocabulary we used, right through to the food and drink we served on the opening night, in order that everyone who participated felt genuinely welcome within the museum. And what I want to talk about now is a few of the strategies that we used to address this kind of particular problem of separating objects from their active context. To begin with, we structured the exhibition according to different strategies of political action, such as direct action, movement building, or prefigurative politics. So rather than by ordering it in terms of chronology or object type, so the objects were introduced according to how they work politically. And we used gallery text and images, film, like the clip you just saw, in order that visitors could see the objects in action. We also used supporting documents that gave an idea of the process of producing the objects and also of their reception. Lots of forms of interpretation that are fairly familiar within the museum. But all of those, really, what you're doing is trying to reintroduce the original context of an object that has essentially been separated from that context and flattened by being brought into the museum. And one of the... One of the issues that came up frequently in our discussions with the lenders was how we might maintain the active integrity of objects. Many of the lenders didn't want visitors and objects to be distanced by barriers. They wanted people to be able to touch the objects, which of course goes against the museum protocols for conservation. The lenders argued that use is preservation, that it's more important to the integrity of the object that it be handled and retain its promise of active use than it is to preserve it in the museum sense by arresting it and stabilizing its material structure. And this proposes an alternative to the familiar idea of the museum as a mausoleum, a final resting place where objects are embalmed when they have no further active role in the world. Rather than finding ways to explain the original context of a now mute object, could the object itself still be active and alive within the exhibition space? Could we think of the objects on display not as butterflies that the collector has killed and pinned in a case, but as not yet finished objects, like a political sticker never stuck, all its hope and rage still held fast to its laminate backing, an object that could still be used. I was inspired by an exhibition I saw in Moscow in 2012 at a design space called Art Play during the height of the anti-Putin demonstrations. Recognizing that there was a new kind of creative protest emerging on the streets of Russia, Art Play put out a call on Facebook asking people to lend their handmade placards and banners for a week-long exhibition. The exhibition, to me, suggested a kind of a new model of what an exhibition might be. It was a space away from the heat and the heat of the protests and the hype of the media for people to stand back and take note of this creative grassroots phenomena. Afterwards, many people collected their placards and took them out on the next demonstration. The exhibition represented a moment in the life of the objects, not their final resting place, a moment of collective meaning-making that didn't seek to entirely enclose the objects or close down their meaning. Their presence in the gallery didn't preclude their ongoing presence in the street. And indeed, in Disobedient Objects, a number of the objects we showed are now continuing their onward journey. And this is a banner by Ed Hall, who for the last 30 years has been the go-to man in Britain if you want a textile marching banner. And on the left, you can see it on the street. It then moved into the V&A exhibition. And then just in the last couple of weeks, it's been popping up in all over the place in momentum rallies, momentum being the new kind of grassroots branch of the British Labour Party. But perhaps the most significant way we found for objects to travel in and out of the museum was through the medium of the how-to guide. There's a long history of social movements recording their design discoveries in practical guides, so they can be passed on to the next group, adapted and developed in order to solve parallel problems by similar means. They facilitate a distributed and networked form of making that we termed swarm design. Following this lead, we produced sheets showing how to make a number of the objects on display, which were available for visitors to take away in the exhibition or to download online. Within the exhibition, these guides encourage visitors to look differently at the objects in front of them, to see them not as the final stage of a design process, but as prototypes that were open at the edges and that invited participation. How-to guides repositioned the exhibition visitor from a passive viewer to a potential maker. And the technological accessibility of these objects represents a kind of mutiny of professional expertise, the idea that you don't have to have had a particular training or be part of a particular kind of practice in order to make an object that can make a difference in the world. And for me, using the how-to guides was really the most satisfying way of framing the makeshift aesthetic of disobedient objects, so not showing them as something that's naive, nor something that delivers a moment of, sort of thrilling authenticity for the detached viewer, but as an agile object that remains ready to act. And in one particular case, this invitation was taken up. I should go back. This is a tear gas mask made from a plastic water bottle, essentially a surgical mask put inside a sliced plastic bottle with some insulating foam and an elastic strap. It was a design that came to our attention during the Gezi Park protests in Istanbul in 2013, although we later discovered it was probably first made and used in Syria. Working with our graphic designer, it wasn't our design, but we formalized it in the form of a how-to guide. And a few weeks after the exhibition opened, the protests started in Ferguson in America over the fatal shooting by the police of an 18-year-old black man, Michael Brown. And people began sharing the V&A guide on social media with the Ferguson hashtag as a suggestion for how protesters might protect themselves against police tear gas attacks. And then a group contacted us to say that they were using the V&A guide to run a tear gas making workshop in Ferguson. And a month later, the how-to guide turned up again in Hong Kong during the Occupy movement there, where again workshops were held in order to make masks for the protesters. And in this graph, we've plotted the downloads of that guide from the V&A website, and the big spike that you see on the 29th of September was the day after the tear gas was first used in Hong Kong. So the exhibition in London helped to propel this object from the protest in Gezi Park to the streets of Ferguson and Hong Kong. Museums have traditionally been actors in processes of cultural diplomacy. This is an alternative form of cultural diplomacy where social movements around the world use the museum to talk to each other and make new things. In this case, at least, disobedient objects appropriated the museum for its own purposes, using the reach of the institution to spread information around the world. And I'm going to finish by playing you a clip of an interview that BBC Radio 4 made with one of the Ferguson protesters who describes what it's like to use the gas mask. And what he says reminds me of how political artist Michael Rakowitz once explained his work as being like a surgical plaster. It's about healing a social problem, but at the same time it serves to make that problem more visible. The primary purpose of the gas mask is to protect the wearer. But the vision of protesters facing a tear gas attack with nothing but a modified plastic water bottle brings home the brutal asymmetry of the police and the protesters in this situation. And perhaps makes the situation feel closer, because a water bottle is something so familiar and everyday, something we all carry. There's three of them on the table in front of me. So I'll finish with this clip.
Tear gas is what I call something to question your citizenship in America. After getting tear gas for a couple days and 1 week, you no longer feel American. It does something to you first, mentally, before it even hits you. You smell the tear gas, it goes in. It's not even air when you breathe it in. So you're actually choking, right? And then you don't know, and you panic. And mentally, you don't know what to do. It takes away your reasoning instantly. You don't know what to do. Then you try to scream, you can't breathe. It goes into your lungs, your chest, you know, it constricts. You can't breathe. You instantly, in like a couple seconds later, all this is in like 10 seconds. Then you just start crying. Tears just flow down, start sneezing, coughing. And if you don't get out of that five-yard ratio, then you instantly go down to the ground. It is the weirdest thing. We got flyers with how to make gas masks. We got videos. A lot of people were trying to make them. Most people didn't have enough money to go buy a military-grade gas mask. So for the common poor people who live in Ferguson, they had like a little learning session here at the Quick Trip and at Greater St. Mark's Church. It was a new process for people who are not science savvy or any, you know, some making makeshift tear gas. We used Hawaiian punch bottles and 2-liter bottles. We cut out the back, you know, cut it in half at the top, leave the bottom. Poke holes in them, use a coffee filter, you know, and then we use a small, like, cut up pieces of towel and drench them in Maalox and lime so it can be like a natural filter so you can breathe. Then we, you know, get some rubber bands and we staple them to the sides of them and you put them on. You know, of course, they're not the military-grade gas masks. They are effective enough to get you out of immediate death and danger.
Thank you so much. We're going to have a discussion now with our three speakers, but in addition, Jonathan Massey is going to be joining us. Jonathan, I think if you've been here for the whole symposium, was the moderator for the first session yesterday, and his bio was given, but I'll just briefly repeat some of that. Jonathan Massey is the Dean of Architecture at CCA, the co-founder of Transdisciplinary Media Studio, and the Aggregate Architectural History Collaborative. His research shows how architecture forms civil society, shapes social relationships, and regulates consumption. His books and essay analyze topics ranging from organicism and ornament in modern architecture to mortgage finance, risk management, and sustainable design. So Jonathan, please come join us, and we can start our discussion. putting sharp intellectual problems, strategies, observations, actions for the future on the table for us. It's really fabulous. In some way, I want to start by seeing whether there are any of you three who have comments to each other about overlaps or disagreements or questions that you have just for each other. And you can say no if you don't want to begin that way. That's okay.
I mean, there probably are, but in a way I'd rather sort of dive into it because I think they'll come out.
Yeah.
I mean, there's actually more overlap than I originally expected because I sort of thought like our practices are all really different and our focuses are different. And But there seems to be an overarching sense of like, okay, how do you survive?
Yeah.
I mean, because of like, you know, very physically, like through the last clip you played, but also like how do you construct narratives to make existence more bearable? And I'm still trying to understand how I fit within that, but I feel like that somehow is my way in. But it's sort of like a different scale of thinking how to survive. But it's I think that might be where it fits together.
I mean, I think that's really helpful because in some ways, survival as an issue implies two things. It means that there's a problem. that struggle is in some way the paradigm that one operates in aesthetically, and the future that we have to actually think now, not just about describing the problematic conditions, but really what is that? But it also in some way implies species, you know, that and in that way I think it changes what we might think of the aesthetic experience from personal or having traditional notions of subjectivity in some way, but this really works at the level of species, and I think that too is part of what comes out by foregrounding the survival tactic that I think you're all in some way interested in.
And I think maybe as well finding sort of non-mainstream methods for making the future.
Right.
Sort of maybe something for me that resonated.
Right.
And also and having to sort of not expect that someone's going to solve the problems for us, but to be involved in that project of making the future.
Right, yeah.
There are two things. One of them I didn't mention. On the Black Lives Matter website, they reference call and response as their mechanism for organization of their protests. So pulling on that, I mean, that history of responding to something happening in the present moment or something happening you want to and doing that in groups of people, large groups or even smaller groups is something that struck me when I saw that on their website. Also this idea, I'm still thinking about the holes in the floor in this church, and it's been there for 300 years, and the idea that in a 4-foot space, you had hundreds of people kind of thinking about a design and the meaning of it, but also responding, you know, breathing through it, you know, so breath, and also sort of together trying to survive and trying to make it to the next phase on the path to freedom was a really great find for me. It really brought a lot of things into context.
Yeah, that's interesting. Jonathan, I don't know, you get to sit back a bit from the three individual projects and see similarities or differences. I don't know whether you had observations that you wanted to.
Just a couple of preliminary thoughts. First of all, thank you for those presentations. I learned about a lot of conversations, concepts, people, and works from each of them that I didn't know about and that connected to things that have been compelling for me in architecture. So the presentations really expanded my frame of reference, which I super appreciated. I guess the other thing I've been thinking about a lot yesterday and this morning is the overall shape of the conference and how, for me, you know, part of what drew me into architecture to begin with was is the concreteness of buildings as aesthetic artifacts. I have a very, in a different sense, object-oriented, I have an object orientation in the sense that I often find, like the work I did on mortgage finance, Peggy, that you referenced, was very intellectually exciting for me, but I reached a point where I just couldn't do it anymore because it's too abstract. And I thought, you know, I believe in this work, but it doesn't excite me because I like to be in contact with designs, with visual imagery, with bodies and buildings and work. And so yesterday's conversation was very valuable for me in deepening my understanding of speculative realism and object-oriented ontology, and understanding to a large extent a conversation that I knew not as well as I would like. And it got me excited about that work, but in a sort of vague way, whereas these presentations that connect more directly to the stakes that matter to people I can recognize in the world around me, that has been very important, very valuable. And just to say one more thought about that, I'm super excited about the conceptual, the intellectual horizons that new materialist philosophy and object-oriented ontology are opening for me. I am concerned as a person with a stake in the future of our discipline and profession and of architecture schools. I'm concerned about one of the risks that comes when you there we go. Thank you. So just one of my fears about putting philosophy with a capital P back at the center of the architecture school conversation is that it risks re-inscribing hierarchies of privilege that are already one of our problems in the architectural discipline. Within academia, philosophy is, let us say, one of the whitest and malest disciplines. And I'm not trying to make so much an essentialist argument as to say that, you know, one of my goals as a person active in architectural education is to recruit a more diverse group of people into our field. To build a pipeline into practice so that the architects of the future will better reflect the range of talent and commitment and objectives out there in the world. One of the risks of reaffirming our relationship with philosophy construed in a certain way is to kind of double down on the Jeffersonian imaginary that is still very strong in our field. The association of architecture, you know, the extent to which architecture is still a bit of a gentleman's game. I wrote about this in Architectural Record last month. I have another piece related to it coming out in December in the Journal of the Society of Architectural Historians about complexity and contradiction, and what does it mean to put Venturian mannerism back on the table in architecture today. And so one of the things I loved about these presentations is that they put in the foreground the aspirations, creative practices, and motivations of a broader range of actors. And I mostly care about the human actors than we might find in the conversation if we focus on texts in the philosophy section.
The other thing I was sharing the story that the dancer that's in the video, Storyboard P, calls himself a mutant, or at least his style is mutant. The Schomburg Center for Research in New York City, there's a cosmogram in the lobby floor by the artist Houston Conwell. Underneath is Langston Hughes' ashes. And they asked me to do a music visualization of jazz improvisation in the cosmogram, which had two large monitors in the lobby. So you had the Houston Conwell's floor installation, and then I was in a circle of people that I didn't really know, and one guy starts to dance, and I realize it's storyboard P.
Oh.
So he's looking at the visual, and he's starting to move, and I'm like, are you storyboard P? You know, and he's like, yeah. You know, so I realized there was something to the aesthetic response, even just in this weird conflation of projection and or display, and then floor installation, the space, which, you know, and this idea of this, the circle, his movements, I was actually able to see him respond to what he was seeing. It was really an amazing moment, and it's in a sort of big marble, you know, mm-hmm. space.
Yeah. I think for the Disobedient Objects exhibition, it was really important, that idea of what you just said, of getting more kind of voices into a kind of very disciplined space. And for the gallery text, we had a system of dual labels. So the curators wrote a label for every object. And then we had a yellow label that was written by someone who'd made or used that object. And we didn't edit it. And that was really, really hard for our museum editors. But it was really trying to sort of, yes, sort of break down the idea of the authoritative voice of the museum and make people feel like they were able to speak there. And that also extended to visitors. We left a blank part of the wall at the end of the exhibition. And it was really supposed to be a kind of poetic statement saying it's impossible to finish an exhibition like this. It can't be enclosed here. There are objects being made out in the world as you're looking. But people started sort of spontaneously adding their own material and messages onto that wall, and we allowed it to kind of to do that and for it to develop. And people, the way people kind of shared their contribution through social media showed that it was really powerful for them to be able to hear it and to have their voice in a space like that.
I just want to say, do I need this? Is this working? Okay. Yes, I do need it, or?
You don't
okay.
need it.
All right, I'm going to put it down. I just to keep things contentious, I think I want to come in on the, I can't believe I'm going to do this, defense of philosophy. only no. Well, steady on.
You need to use the mic.
I do need to use. I do need.
So
to use the mic.
Repeat that provocative statement with the mic.
The defense of philosophy. But more like as a position. Like yes, it's there are a lot of white dudes in philosophy, and that. But I think if you just go in and presume this is my territory. This is, some of it's useful. It doesn't necessarily need to be, you don't need to be so completely reverential around it, but there is it's a useful tool for thinking. I mean, you know, so I don't want to be totally, I'm reluctant to totally give philosophy a kicking just because its history is white and male. I mean, I think a case can be made for just presuming, yes, that's its history, and we're here now, and we will have that. Thank you very much.
Just to say, it's clear that the three of you can be as articulate about your projects and further it for all of us, because you've done a lot of thinking. I mean, clearly we can't divide those worlds in an absolute way, and I don't think, Jonathan, in any way you intended to do that.
I just want to say, really, you know, so I was a PhD student only a few years ago, and we had to read 200 texts just determined by the faculty in order to get to the next phase, which was to take exams and then work on our thesis. Out of the 200 texts, none were of color, and three were women. So this is what we're giving our exams on to pass and to move forward. So the first year, you have no choice. The second year, a fourth of that, you can add your own. And what that did for me, because there's no representation for me within this area, this domain, I actually had to work harder to dig up people and scholars and texts that sort of fit where I wanted to go with it, which was looking at technology, looking at space and time from a non-Western lens. So it made me work harder, but I remember when I did my oral examination, and one of the faculty said, this makes me uncomfortable. And that's not a bad thing. He said, it makes me uncomfortable, it's not a bad thing, because what it means is I know nothing about this area. And so it's going to be on you to sort of not help him become comfortable, but to really be the expert, which has its own problems. So that's something that might, for someone who doesn't have the confidence or someone who feels like there's no one in the field that looks like me, that may be a little challenging because you're walking into a situation where people aren't comfortable with something as opposed to there's somebody in the room that understands and kind of you can get feedback from. And that can be very alienating in that sense for the student, you know, and for as well as the professor. So
if I could just picking up on Nettrice, what you just said, and Diann, a little bit, just to clarify, I probably didn't express maybe quite what I was thinking. It's not that I don't value the work of philosophy, and it's not that I don't want to keep it vitally engaged in the architectural conversation. It's a little bit a question of what do you lead with, and so if architecture school education is a bit like the experience Nettrice described, where in semester one you read Vitruvius, and if you want to do your thesis on Afrofuturism, great, and you get feminism in week 13 of the theory survey, but you start with a canon of certain kind of authors, then there's a kind of filtering mechanism in terms of who's gonna, and it's really about of who's gonna enlist for that academic program, who's gonna commit their excited early years of college, and it's not that the philosophy won't be valuable to them; it's that they may choose a different field. Because there's a lot of black excellence out there. There's a lot of, you know, feminist talent that is going to look at that and say, it's not worth my time. I can make a ton more money, and I can become an upper middle class professional in another way without the uphill battle. And so I feel like, what if we led in thinking about the curriculum of an architecture school? Shouldn't we start with the question of what matters to the people we want to join us in this field? And can we build a curriculum that starts with their priorities and shows why architecture is worth, like, what we have to offer to addressing those concerns, whether it's xenofeminism or Afrofuturism? That's the dream I would like to get to, where philosophy comes in to enrich a set of questions that are set by a vision of a more just field.
In some way, I want to pursue what leading off with discussions and presentations like this would be in an architecture school, because it's not architecture per se, and whether that matters or not. But I'm not going to do that right now. I think that will maybe come up in the second session or at the end of this discussion. But I just also wanted to point out that, and this kind of dumbs down the larger issue that we're talking about the gender and race of the figures that model our architecture education, but bring it down to just the observation that all of your works are collaborative, and I don't think that's incidental to the content of what you're doing. And in some way, this is related to observations that were made yesterday about whether the subject of the aesthetic experience is a singular person or whether you're part of a socioeconomic historical condition. But this is slightly different than that, not just reception, but really that you can't make without it being a community that you're talking about, whether it's in the collaborative curatorial notions you have, but also how the objects in there were all part of a collaborative process, and all of you seeing that you're workers, the people who you're getting information from, you're gathering around, you're speaking to and speaking for, are not empowered by individual work or your individual work, but together you perform that work and you make that work. I think that's an important thing to put on the table around a discussion of aesthetics. Okay, I mean, if you don't want to talk about that, we can go.
Actually, I
okay. Yeah.
I mean, we wrote this text as a it's true that actually almost everything I almost all of my practice now as an artist is various collaborations. I suppose in a way, because I think because I am interested in systems, and I think going in and trying to make the claims I'm making yet be some single individual sort of like, you know, braving through it, it sort of seems like, well, that's not going to work. You know, the projects I'm involved with are already hubristic enough. You know, and at least if I have compatriots in my hubris, maybe it'll be more feasible. Because I do think if you're going to start thinking about the future and thinking about change and thinking about building it, it's going to have to be cross-disciplinary. And you can't know everything. I mean, I'm coming from an arts background. I mean, that can only do so much, you know. So, I mean, I think if I want to actually have art live up to the claims that it often makes, the grand claims that it often makes, it's not going to be able to do it on its own, and I'm going to need to sort of pair up with people with different expertise, whether it be technology, whether it be architecture, whether it be planning. This is sort of my direction that I'm going in, but I think it has to happen more broadly as well. That if, because of how we live, because of the complexity of how we live, this sort of cross-thinking and cross-fertilization and decanonizing things, stop being so reverential about disciplines and what they're supposed to be. I mean, I know everybody sings the praises of multidisciplinarity, and that's not anything particularly revolutionary, but I think within my own practice, it's something that it seems like it has to go that way. It doesn't make sense to be squirreling away in my studio by myself, you know, making discrete objects in the same way. Not to say that that can't happen or that can't be part of it, but it's, you know, but it has to be part of something else, and that involves people that do things other than, I mean, that don't do what I do.
Yeah, I mean, within the museum, it was kind of essential that if we'd followed our normal practices and not kind of collaborated, then it would have been a completely different exhibition. I think it would have been a failure. But for the social movements, I mean, the key is their social movements. And it's not just about what they're making, but it's how they're interacting while they make it. So there was a lot of criticism of the Occupy movement that it didn't achieve its goals, whatever those kind of goals exactly were defined. But one of the kind of counter arguments to that was it was actually about sort of making a new world in the present and showing that you can relate to each other differently and playing with social structures and kind of showing that the kind of future you want to create can exist sort of now and you can start to live it. So that actual collaborative working is as much a part of the work as the as any other part of the protest, really.
One more thing. So I discovered at some point in my studies that John Coltrane studied physics. And I was like, oh. So, you know, then there's, you know, a book, and there were some interviews, and enough of him talking about it. And then I said to some high school students I teach AP computer science to, oh, John Coltrane studied physics, and forgot about it. And then one of my students wanted to do a project to explore theory of relativity and jazz improvisation. But this particular, so we're in a computer science class, and this is what she wants to do as extra credit, and she's a visual art major, senior in high school. And suddenly I realized we're in multiple modalities here. We're having in the language of film to demonstrate theory of relativity and jazz improvisation. And if we wanted to push further and she had more time, which relates to computer science, we could look at how what that looks like as visualization. So there's animation in the video. So this, we've moved, and what I realized by opening up or working in multiple modalities opens up for this kind of exchange, but also these students are, and they're Black, Latino, Asian, and white, and you know, and they're very diverse, but they see themselves more in that space, this new modality, this interdisciplinary, cross-disciplinary space. Where they begin to, and then my role as an educator is to sort of make that feel normal. Like, this is not unusual. So the things that they do in this classroom, I'm like, meh. But behind the scenes or on social media, these kids are amazing. Oh my God, you know, so, and I do that all the time. I'm like, you know, okay, yeah, that's cool. You're composing to some data sets. That's great. But I'm like, oh my God, they get it, you know, so, and I want them to know, because computer science is another field that's dominated primarily by white men, but these students are not thinking about that. They don't know, and they are thinking about how their work, their interests, their culture, their community, whatever, relates to the topics at hand. So you're creating a space for this kind of work. So you do come out, you know, coming out of your comfort zone in a sense, but also allowing them to feel more comfortable in this kind of risk-taking new space that's evolving and you don't know where it's going.
It is part of those different modalities that you're talking about, and John Coltrane, you know, studying physics, makes me think about the emphasis on technology that I think runs through all of your talks. And in some way, the technology is a strategy for survival. In some way, the technology is also a way of describing that we're a different kind of species now than we were before. And if we don't embrace that or understand that, we're not going to project correctly into the future. And I just think that technological framing also shifts the kind of definition of aesthetics that isn't pure in some way. It's not pure as a technique, and it's not pure as something that frames our subjectivity in some way. But if you want to comment on that before we open this up to questions, or yeah, okay. You have a question.
Preserving the right of prima nocte to come after Jonathan. So, I think what you said was contentious and surprising, given that like the two keynotes for Céline Sciarri and Jacques Rancière both emerged from a discourse of philosophy and have dedicated their life to linking justice and equality via philosophy. And one of the comments Jacques makes in several of his books is about certain hierarchies, and of course there's an irony of you as a white male dean telling us what shouldn't be in architecture school, which is a hierarchical position in and of itself. And I just worry, I mean, my skin started crawling when I thought that if we can't allow philosophy in architecture because of its patriarchal white male history, should we not allow architecture in cities because of its patriarchal white male history? Like, where do you stop? And where does that point like obscure the ability to actually repair the damage that's been done historically?
I clearly didn't articulate my thoughts clearly enough. I am deeply inspired by the political questions that this stream of philosophy raises. I must not have expressed that clearly. It is not that I don't think it should be. I think it has huge value to enrich our conversation. My concern is about how we frame those questions and how we open them up in the discipline. So one of the things that I often fear, I look at the architectural complicity in urban renewal, for instance, which was done under the sign of the best political intentions. And I sometimes fear that the reparative work, that the disciplinary reorientations that we kick into gear to undo the damage, may be starting a new cycle, right? And it's not that I think architecture should withdraw from trying to engage with big social and political questions. It's that I think if those of us already in positions of privilege in a fairly sociologically conservative field, if we believe that we're the ones who know the right answer, we risk just reinscribing our privilege by telling people in a kind of patriarchal or a kind of paternalistic way, we have the secret knowledge that's going to help you in your situation. Whereas my dream is that we partner with the people whose causes we want to advance, and in dialogue with them, we identify the knowledge that's going to make the change in a way that includes them as agents from the beginning, which might lead us to the very same texts.
Yeah,
which might lead us to the very same texts. But I don't. I recognize that I don't know what I can't know what is going to be most valuable to the people who are missing from my professional world. I need them to help answer that.
I just have to pipe in with. I mean, if philosophy shows anything, it's those shows that you don't know the right answer. I mean, that's sort of like what it does best is like be like, well, no, you're probably wrong. Like whatever you think, it's probably wrong. And that is why I think it does need to be. I mean, yes, it needs to be, opened up. Sort of, you look at philosophy departments, and it is exactly what you say. It's not terribly different with architecture departments. Art departments are a different story, but gender. If you look at the field of art, I don't want to get into that. That's a whole other conversation. But I think using it as a way to show people that they will probably never know as much as they want to know, regardless of where they're coming from, is sort of one of the things that it can do.
Just a really brief comment. I think it's worth remembering that philosophy doesn't just happen in universities. A lot of the activists that we work with in Disobedient Objects had deeply theoretical positions and arguments with us about what we were doing, but not necessarily in that kind of formal institutional framework.
Is this on? Yeah, thank you. Presentations were just staggeringly good, and there are so many questions kind of in your work, the diverse form of work you're involved in, that are super interesting for this project, I think. But I just I was struck by something when I was sort of writing down ideas about what each of you are doing, and some of which is advocacy work, different variety of things. I have often led in architectural curriculum. I have often been led to think about Sesame Street. Do you remember Sesame Street? Because Sesame Street was, incredibly inventive children's television show filled with all sorts of, wildly funny and hilarious things. And also you thought, oh, wow, this is the most incredibly creative, how do they get it to be so, I don't know what it's like now. I haven't watched it in years, but it was, it just seemed to be an incredible show. And then it turned out, the producer said, well, we have only one question we're trying to answer every single day, one question. And that's what everything is oriented to. And that question is, basically, does this educate the child? And you think, wow, that's very pedantic and dogmatic. How could they possibly have gotten this kind of creative burst or this massive amount of, mileage out of that one idea? But in fact, it conditions everything in the show in a kind of brilliant way, and there was this infusion of that idea with this creative energy. And I would say, in a certain sense, that actually coming up with such a question, which is going to sound ridiculous at a certain moment, like architecture, school should be about every single thing, should be about, okay, what does this have to do with architecture? And you would say, well, that's totally reductive. We can't possibly do that. And yet it torques things, already engendering a kind of creative relationship to that question, including diverse questions of audience, diversity, everything else. And so it's just, or it could be another question. It could be everything, what is the you know, so everything has to be connected with the problem of aesthetics or something. I mean, you know, there are a variety of ways of, it's a very hard thing to do, but at the same time it's generative. If it's done with the idea that then creativity kind of is allowed to operate on that question. And so I think people, I mean, I thought these presentations, all of them are just, you know, so amazing. I just had kind of one question for Nettrice that I can talk about later if people want to pursue the philosophy question, but it had to do with the cosmogram, is that what it is? And the fluidity of the ability to pass over the lines, and I don't know whether they're fluid or not. Some are fluid and some aren't, or the passage from life to death is fluid or not. Are there different weights to those territories proscribed? Not in the, let's say, you know, obviously I'm interested in these issues of property, not necessarily in contemporary property boundary, but some kind of territorial relationships that so that the dancer can pass through them, but somebody else cannot, or whatever, and the inscription, various inscriptions of that diagram has more dynamic potential, or is it a dynamic diagram in the sense that it can be continuously interpreted, or does it have a base interpretation that has to remain in place, the cross or the diagram itself or something? So I'm just curious about the, you know, the dynamic potential of that. But I can talk to you about that later or something if people want to pursue the. There be philosophy or not, the answer is yes, of course there should be.
The video that I showed, the reason why I like it is that the director, Khalil Joseph, he purposefully used the cosmogram as a way to sort of create the film. So whether it's the blood that's going counterclockwise or the bullets in the circular, he found a pool in LA that had the circle. There are things, but there's physical, he was literally shooting like from birth all the way through and really showing kind of the fluidity, because there was both life and death in that very short 4 minute video that's part of life every day in Nickerson Gardens in Los Angeles. And you know, right now we have, I keep thinking about Trump and you go outside, you get shot. Just things that he says that isn't entirely true. People are alive and they're going, what do you mean? This doesn't happen on my block and I'm in Chicago. You know, I find that there's this, the flexibility of being able to imagine your body being in different states is something that is very prevalent and speculative, from Octavia Butler to when they're moving through time and space and they die and come back somebody else. There's a lot of this kind of back and forth movement through time and space. But also there's the dancer or the performer who's in a physical space who's also going through some types of transformations that I think are very, have a lot of potential in terms of how we construct space or what we think of as space. And what we think of as time, because that space-time idea. Because of the dance that I'm doing with students around jazz improvisation and physics, I'm becoming more aware that Einstein studied music. And for him, physics was music. And he played a violin, and he would also play music to solve some of his theories. And he would, you know, his wife said, you know, he would play for all day, and he would go, okay, I figured that out, and he, you know, and go to bed. So this kind of merging of things that are happening is something that can't really happen if you just stay within jazz or if you just stay within quantum mechanics. It has to happen when those boundaries become blurred. And I think visually, and also just in terms of how it works conceptually, the idea of a water boundary or an area where things can just kind of move through. Back and forth is something that has the ability to really change the way we think of in terms of the spaces we're in and what we're doing at the time and where we're in and how we interact with each other is also there too. So I think I like it because, and I keep coming back to it because of the possibilities that it brings. And so, and the many different interpretations that I showed, both physical and also digital or whatever, I think really explore those things. And so in 2 years of studying this, I keep finding new things and finding new ways to think about it.
Hello. Oh my God, I've got like a thousand zillion questions, but I think I'm going to stick to like an educate me question, which is, Nettrice, can you tell me more about the fractal quality of the cosmograms?
Ron Eaglash, who was on my committee, he's at RPI. He's a computer scientist / STS guy. He went to Africa, got up on a building, and realized that the villages were all based on fractals. So he has a TED talk about it, I think in Turkey. But you know, I've seen high school math teachers get really excited because he realized that there was this sort of recursive design that was happening in the villages that showed up in some of the textiles that showed up again and again. And then the cosmogram being a geometric device and a geometric shape also plays a role in that because of its nature. And so when I started working with Ron, he said, well, I want to support your thesis. So we started developing software to teach kids how to simulate the cosmogram using some of Ron's work or his lab's work. So it's the idea of it being fractal, there's almost a nature to it, the recursion of it, and what happens when you break it apart and it's from larger to smaller. That's the fractal nature of it. And so you can actually see it, visualize it, and it's a geometry, but it's also just the nature of which it happens, and it happens naturally. It's not something, they're not architects in those villages, and they had to get permission to get up on the, you know, like, what does this white guy from Troy, New York want to get on my house? And look at my, you know, and he's like, I'm looking at, you know, fractals. You know, I mean, you know, and Ron's very, you know, and the idea that, you know, there were moments when I couldn't figure it out. And there would be a moment when I would submit a graph or a chart, and he was like, oh, you're ready. Okay, you know, it would be these moments. But, you know, if you look at traditional African-American quilts, they're different than European quilts, where they're very fractal-based. And they break up the space, and then they show recursion. You see that again and again. So what we're talking about is something that's just, it's a part of nature, it's part of structures, and when we think about that, but it's also part of a community of practice. And it's also part of the Middle Passage being a rupture, and that being a part of a mentality or awareness going into the creative space that I think is something that also, because the music's also fractal. The idea that you're breaking up the break dancing, you know, you're breaking up space, you're sampling, taking a piece, and you're putting other different samples together. It just keeps going on and on.
Back there's a question. Sorry.
I guess one of the things that I'm interested in this talk, which I really, really enjoyed everything that you sort of bring to the table, and especially maybe the way you're kind of activating the idea of activism in the context of our symposium. But I wonder if maybe part of what we're wrestling with as a group is the idea of representation. And in a way, I guess I think, I don't know that I see such a tremendous difference, for instance, between how a cosmogram operates, how a building operates, maybe also how like philosophical reason is working. I mean, in some ways, I feel like these things are presenting structures that try to organize and locate the individual in space and time. And I guess I was interested in seeing if that seemed like a useful thought to you all, if that doesn't seem on point, or any of your reflections.
Do you have a cosmic interest? No.
Can I interfere here if you're all grappling with what you're dying to? I wonder whether Jonathan can answer that, because in some way I see that what interests me is the insertion of architecture in that, not within the larger realm of representation, whether it's philosophic representation or visual representation, because I think the harder one to get into that group is architecture, I would say. So I'm curious, actually, to hear the architect do that. But if you don't want to...
I don't know that I have a ready answer, but if I could just pick up on the quilting comment, it made me think about the Black Lives Matter essay collection that Meredith Tenhor and I edited last year, some of the responses and some of the material we published took up this question of a kind of black formalism and the ways that jazz or hip-hop or the improvisational structures of those musical genres and dance practices and quilting, they suggested a very productive potential space for interleaving that with formalist approaches to architecture that would bring those representational strategies into architectural creativity and generate, who knows what, something interesting.
Do you want to say about that specifically?
So just the one of the images I showed is John Coltrane created a sketch in the 60s. It's a device you play giant steps with. So you attach musical notes to it, and you move the triangle and the circle of fit and fifths to basically compose giant steps. So my goal, something I want to do that's sort of DIY, is I want to construct it. I want to make it, and I want to see, you know, how that device becomes a structure that you can play, that you can interact with, that goes beyond the sketch that he created to teach how to play the song. And so when we think about we can create structures that are flat, but also structures that are interactive, or structures that engage people in the space. It moves more towards the architectural side of things than on the two-dimensional or philosophical or conceptual side of things.
I guess I just had to think about it a minute. You know, the question of representation. I mean, you know, when I first was in an email conversation with Mark about doing this and thinking about, you know, the way xenofeminism uses alienation and thinking about that around aesthetics, and Mark and I had this email back and forth about, like, how do you know what the new is? It's going to be alien. And I think I agree with that, trying to think, like, how xenofeminism, for example, like, is represented. And the more I thought about it, the more I thought, like, okay, well, I have an aesthetic that I work with as an artist. I don't know that I'm ready to claim that it is I'm definitively not ready to claim that it is the way xenofeminism needs to be represented. For example, like, there's six of us that sort of wrote this text, but actually there's ambitions for it sort of not being just the six of us even. So it's like I work within a particular aesthetic. The work I do has a particular aesthetic. You know, guided by my interest, and there are reasons for why I choose the aesthetic I do, but it's not the one. So in a way, like, the question of representation, it sort of threw me back to this thing of, like, tell me we're not just modernists, because the whole thing of, like, form following function thing, it seemed like, okay, well, actually that sort of seems apt, like, things need to look the way they do because of what they do. But I think maybe where it shifts now is it's not so much just form follows function around something like a chair. It's sort of form follows function of an entire network, and how does that, and what is the aesthetic of that? Like, when you have something like how do you have an aesthetic of something that's de-individuated? So trying to think about aesthetics on that line and try to represent, like, how do you think even about representation, you know, if you're trying to think systemically? Like, you know, do I just show some shipping containers? I mean, that doesn't really get to it either. It's like it'll kind of tell you what I'm talking about, but it doesn't sort of capture it. So I think trying to think about representation and aesthetics of this kind of thinking is, I suppose it's really nascent. It does in some ways come out of this form follows function, but I think what that is now, because of our technology, because of what we are, is kind of just emerging and trying to be defined. So I don't know if that really gets to your question. I guess I had to think about it a bit.
I'll just interject here. And this is totally my opinion, but I guess I want to get it out there from a discussion, because I guess we're moving on to more architectural. Yeah. But just to say, I don't think architecture is primarily representational. I think it is. And I think it shapes space and it divides people and allows people to see each other and you know, organizes people in relationship to each other that is not primarily in a representational way. I don't think that it's coincidental that we're seeing art practices here and we're not seeing architecture practices here. It makes me, the closest thing to architecture
and all of this is architecture in some way, I want to admit, but the closest thing that looked like was the silver cube that, you know, makes this kind of false bow, which very much reminded me of the kind of performances in the 70s in Austria, the Coupe Himmelblau, everything is architecture, and they're wearing masks in the street, and they're walking down bubbles. It's a way of making both the body and the clothing and the environments and the technologies that we use be architecture. Very, very activist, very critical. We see what happened to Coupe Himmelblau. You know, I can't help but think that there is something that makes architecture resist the way that we can communicate as, I don't know, sensuously, directly, visually, as art. But that's a probably controversial statement. You've been dying to, and this will be the last question.
It's a simple question. If we were to colonize Mars and build a school there, what would your canon be and what would you take? I would like each of your answers, please.
That's your simple question. If we were to build, if there was something in Mars, what would we take?
So I was so provocative, so many of the ideas that you threw out and about, I thought, well, what if you could have a tabula rasa for a new canon? Because Nettrice started to talk about how she got up against that canon during your PhD program, and I had a similar experience at Yale when I proposed yoga and architecture. And they gave me to Kent Bloomer, and the first thing he said was, they give me all the crazies. I ended up having a great experience. I'm here because I love it. But if you could build a whole new school, a whole new library on another planet, and you can decide what part of the canon you would bring, I just want to know what each one of you are, what would that look like?
Yeah, maybe, yeah. Some, I'd bring the internet. It's like a desert island disc question. I always thought that would be my answer. My luxury would be would bring the internet and Skype. But I don't know. I mean, I probably shouldn't be taking your question so literally. I mean, I quite like the idea of like what it means to start building on Mars. And actually, I think I'm just a materialist, and I start thinking about like how you would survive. So that's sort of where my head goes with that question. And I think that's probably not what you mean. Yeah, I the internet, I guess.
It's interesting. So I think a lot of what Gavin and I were discussing with Disobedient Objects was trying not to create a canon, and saying that you know it was quite good to come up with a term like Disobedient Objects that didn't already have a kind of a weight, and we weren't trying to kind of define a very specific typology of objects. So we were quite kind of resistant to the idea that anything we put in the exhibition would then kind of, you know, be seen as a canon. So taking something to Mars, which would both kind of be an opportunity to stop telling history from above and to have your, yeah, to be able to choose what you tell, but then you're obviously thinking about the future as well. So I think not that dissimilar to the internet, it would probably be a mixture of the how-to guides that I was talking about, which have a long history, which still have that kind of active nature in the future as well.
Can I add one more thing to my former answer? I guess it's that I think I have a problem with the question, actually, because in a way I don't feel like it's useful to think about what do you do with a year zero, because that's not going to happen, you know. And actually the problems that we are facing are very real and really complicated and difficult, and it's like we're not going to get the tabula rasa. It's not an option. You know, it's like we've got to deal with sort of where we are, the mess of it, the muck of it, the ways it doesn't work, and actually try to find a way to engineer ourselves out of it. And actually, you know, like I was saying, it's like we as a species have the capacity to do, God, I'm going to sound like the end of Contact or something. We have the capacity for reason, but you know, if you look at something like Aleppo, it's like it goes beyond what one could imagine as being absolutely horrible. So it's like we're not going to get that. You know, even like if we do go to another planet, and I'm totally on board with that, like, but it's not going to be, it's not a tabula rasa. It that will never happen. So in a way, it's I think more useful to think about what do we do given that that's not an option.
I met the deputy director of NASA. We had some discussions about how would you teach, you know, about the mission to Mars. I did a summer program with some students around that mission. And one of the students in her presentation said, why are we worried about colonizing Mars? We can't get it together here. And this is a young person. And she had a point. You know, we're going to go and create the same problem on Mars that we have the problem here. That doesn't make a lot of sense, you know, putting all that time and effort and money into doing the same thing that we're already having to deal with here. And so that's one issue. I would take Amiri Baraka's technology and ethos with me because it's a more humanistic view of technology that I have read. It was done in 1970, 71, 72, was written. And this idea of technology being a typewriter, being a pencil, being a, you know, being lots of different things, but an expression scriber. And he gives this kind of idea of a technology that's more humanistic that I think leads to us thinking differently about our existing structures and existing systems that I think would really challenge us to begin to fix some of the mess that we are dealing with here so that when we do get to Mars, because they're still aiming for that, that we are not taking the same, we're not going to recreate what we have here. Mm.
We could build the giant inflatable assembly rather than have a parliament building.
Yeah.
Okay. I think that has to be it. Huge round of thank yous and appreciation.